President and Mr. Speaker, and members of the United States Congress, I come to this House of the People to speak to you and all Americans, certain that we stand at a defining hour. Halfway around the world, we are engaged in a great struggle in the skies and on the seas and sands. We know why we're there. We are Americans, part of something larger than ourselves. For two centuries, we've done the hard work of freedom, and tonight, we lead the world in facing down a threat to decency and humanity. What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind: peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law. Such is a world worthy of our struggle and worthy of our children's future.
The New World Order, a lecture examining the plan for a new civilization being offered to the world by a 6,000-year-old human conspiracy. For the sake of any dated material inside this lecture, the lecture was delivered on May the 2nd, 1994. Good afternoon. My name is Ralph Epperson, and I would like to thank you for watching this video entitled The New World Order. I truly appreciate the fact that you are allowing me this opportunity to discuss some very controversial ideas with you. I think the first place to start this lecture would be with an explanation of who I am and why I wanted to make this video. I am a graduate of the University of Arizona, and I thought that that meant that I had been educated. It took me several years to discover that I had been lied to during my 4 years at college, because what I have discovered in the years since graduation has convinced me that what the college professors call history, political science, and economics is simply not true. After graduation, I moved to California, and I soon began to feel that I did not know enough to vote wisely on the choices shown on the California ballot, so I decided that I had to learn more. I joined a group called the Young Republicans and asked them to educate me on both the issues of the day and the candidates on the California ballot. At one of their early meetings, I met a young man named Jim, who later became a close friend of mine. He suggested that I start reading what he called revisionist history, and I had to admit that I had never heard of that term. He suggested that I start reading books on the subject, and I reluctantly did as he suggested. I started that reading in 1963. I must admit that I now know what revisionist history means. I have discovered that history needs to be revised. What we call history today is simply a fairy tale. As I continued reading, I found the evidence that there is a massive conspiracy at work in the world, and that part of their efforts have been directed into covering up their involvement in the major events of the past. And that is why there must be efforts to uncover the evidence that they are trying to suppress. I am quite aware that few Americans will watch this video, even though I will do everything within my power to make it available to the largest possible market. And it would be a reasonable question to ask why it is that I would take so much of my time to make this video when I know it will not be a huge success. The only answer I can offer is that I feel I simply have to. And the reason I must do so is because I believe that all men and women of morality must do all within their power to expose this conspiracy, whether or not we are successful. This conspiracy that I've discovered is worldwide and is extremely powerful. It has caused wars, revolutions, and depressions all over the world in the past 200 to 300 years. So for the last 30 years, I have been sharing my research with those who will take the time to read one of my books or watch one of my videos. I have written 2 books, 5 booklets, and a series of videos that I think will be adequate to convince you that there is something going on in this world. I will discuss my 2 books during the main part of this lecture. So what will follow will be a brief introduction to the material I have produced to convince you that there is indeed a master conspiracy at work in America. This is the first of my 5 booklets, and the title of this one is God Exists, and it presents the evidence that there is a God in the universe. The reader can know with scientific certainty that there is a creator God in the universe, and that a belief in God is no longer a faith, it will be a reality. The second is a booklet that discusses the war in Vietnam. It is entitled Vietnam, America's Betrayal and Treason. This booklet will discuss the evidence that the American government planned the war in 1945, armed both sides, and then intentionally frustrated the efforts of the fighting forces to win the war. This is a videotape lecture of the same material in the book. This is a booklet that I have written to review a new constitution for the United States called the New Constitution of the United Republics of America. The document was written in 1970 and may very well be the one to replace the Constitution of the United States. Those who know anything at all about the American Constitution will not like this new document. There will be no government protected rights under this new Constitution if we adopt it. This is a booklet entitled Clinton's Conspiracy that discusses the evidence that our new president knows that there is a conspiracy at work in the world, and secondly, that he supports it. This book will document those statements. I think you would agree with me that it is a truly serious problem when the President of the United States admits that there is a bloody conspiracy at work in the world and that he supports it. But that is exactly what Bill Clinton said. This is a video lecture presenting the same material as in the booklet. This is the 5th of these booklets, and it is entitled Jesse James, U.S. Senator. It is my contention that Jesse James, this nation's most famous outlaw, did not die in 1882 as history has recorded. He lived to be 107 years of age, and during the time between when he supposedly died and when he actually died, he was a major player inside the inner core of this conspiracy. If I am right, Jesse James the outlaw sat in the Senate of the United States for 1 term from 1901 to 1907. This could very well be the story of the century because Jesse was right in the middle of the major stories of his lifetime. This is a video of the lecture that I gave called Jesse James, United States Senator. This contains the same material as does the booklet. In addition to the books and booklets I have written, I've also produced a series of videos, some of which we've already talked about. This is the video of the New World Order lecture being taped today. This is the lecture I first gave in 1985 entitled Secret Societies and the New World Order. I first started warning America about the New World Order in 1985, 5 years before George Bush started talking about the phrase. So I saw it coming and tried to warn as many people as I could. This is a series of 27 one-hour lectures called Secrets of History. This group of 5 videotapes is basically the tape version of my book entitled The Unseen Hand. This is a 2-hour lecture that discusses the evidence that President John Kennedy was assassinated by a conspiracy in 1963 because he wanted to get America out of Vietnam, a war that had been planned by high-ranking officials in the American government in as early as 1945. The real reason that President Kennedy was murdered has not been made public until now. I will make that reason known for the first time in America during this video. This is a video that shows the driver of the limousine that President Kennedy was seated in firing the fatal shot into the head of the president. It is called The Driver Shot the President. This is a video entitled Happy 4th of July. The American people do not know that the founding fathers of this nation created 2 separate federal governments, when they wrote the Constitution of the United States, and that they gave one of those two governments absolute tyrannical power over the people of the United States, and that this is the government running America today. Big government is constitutional, and our founding fathers wanted it that way. This is a book that I did not write but wish that I did. It is called The Law and was written in 1850 by Frederick Bastiat, a French statesman and writer. This booklet is the best book I've ever read on the function of government, and if I could be president of the United States for one day, I would make it mandatory that every American read this book. I feel that the books, booklets, and videos that I've produced since 1985 are the best on the market on this subject. I believe that my research has been thorough enough to prove the existence of this conspiracy to everyone, including even the most skeptical American. And the evidence that I have found for this lecture today will be very startling and frightening to the viewer. But I want you to know that I have spent 30 years of my life in researching the evidence that it is true. I also believe that the American people should know the truth about what those conspirators have planned for the future of America. As I continued reading after 1963, I continued to find the evidence that there is a massive conspiracy at work in the world and that part of their efforts have been directed into covering up their involvement in the major events of the past. And that is why there must be efforts to uncover the evidence that they are trying to suppress. I am quite aware that few Americans will watch this video, even though I will do everything within my power to make it available to the largest possible market. And it would be a reasonable question to ask why it is that I'm making this video. And as I said in my introduction, I feel I simply have to. Because all moral men and women must do all they can to expose this conspiracy. Because as I'm repeating myself again, to make the point, this conspiracy that I have discovered is worldwide and is extremely powerful. It has caused wars, revolutions, and depressions all over the world in the past 200 to 300 years. As I continued my reading, I became aware that there are basically only two explanations of the causes of the past, what I have called the accidental view of history and the conspiratorial view of history. The accidental view holds that the major events of the past have occurred by accident for no determinable cause. People were powerless to prevent the major events of the past from happening, and the reason for that is because they just happen, and no one knows why they do. The alternative view to the accidental view is called the conspiratorial view, and it holds that the major events of the past have been caused by a conspiracy intent on causing these events to happen to further their secret goals. After some 22 years of studying what I then called revisionist history, I wrote and then published my first book entitled The Unseen Hand, An Introduction to the Conspiratorial View of History in 1985. This is a history book explaining why the major events of the past 200 years in America have occurred. This book does not explain why these events were caused to happen, just that there was a conspiracy behind their planning. So for the first 25 years of that research, I did not know what the motive of this conspiracy was. I had not done enough research into why they have been creating these events so harmful to the people of the world. I have been told by others that the motive of this conspiracy was money, but this view does not explain why this conspiracy has murdered millions of innocent people. I was told that the motive was power, but that does not explain why the conspirators have set out to destroy religion as they have. So I started looking into the true motive, and about 4 years ago, I think I found it. I now know why the world has been plagued by wars, revolutions, famines, and depressions. I now know why this conspiracy has been involved in the major events of the past. So in 1990, I wrote and then published my second book entitled The New World Order. It was my purpose to expose as much of the workings of this conspiracy at one time as I could. I want you to know that even though this lecture is about 14 hours long, it is still not long enough to cover what I wanted to put into it. There is a wealth of material that I have read that I felt could have been added, but that I thought should be left out only because it would take too long to cover. I know that this will be a long lecture, but I want you to know that I believe it could be the most important video you might ever watch. So please understand that this is only a small smattering of what I could have put into this lecture. I've actually tried to keep it as short as I could. There is something coming. This thing coming is not very pleasant, and it is called the New World Order. One of the things that has impressed me the most about what I found was the fact that I was not the only one who believed that this conspiracy exists. This is a book entitled The Externalization of the Hierarchy, written by Alice Bailey, a writer on occult, meaning secret, and hidden matters. She is a supporter of this conspiracy, one that I will be quoting quite frequently during this lecture, and this is how she sees how it has operated for centuries. The only thing that humanity needs today is the realization that there is a plan, which is definitely working out through all world happenings, and that all that has occurred in man's historical past and all that has happened lately is assuredly in line with that plan. This is Benjamin Krem, a believer in a new religion that is currently spreading all over the world called the New Age religion. He is also speaking about the coming New World Order all over the world. And he is not in opposition to the New World Order, he is in support of it. This is a book that he has written called The Reappearance of the Christ and the Masters of Wisdom. He wrote this on pages 28 and 29 of that book. In every age, teachers have come forth to enable mankind to take its next evolutionary step. They are the custodians of a plan for the evolution of humanity and the kingdoms of nature. This plan works out through the agency of this esoteric hierarchy of masters. By the way, the word esoteric means hidden or concealed, who substand all world events and constitute the invisible because unknown government of the planet. And on page 78 of his other book, entitled Maitreya's Mission, he tells us that the personnel, masters and high initiates of the hierarchy have worked esoterically, once again meaning they've worked secretly, behind the scenes of our everyday life. The spiritual hierarchy has been in existence for about 17 million years. So this is why I am making this video. I want you, the viewer, to know that there is a conspiracy at work in the world that is planning our future, and that that future is called the New World Order. It might be helpful at this point to use a simple illustration for those who do not believe in the conspiratorial view of history. I am reminded of the little boy who goes to sleep at night only to wake up during the night because the boogeyman is in the corner of his room. The little boy screams and his father comes into the bedroom and the father asks for an explanation and the little boy screams out that there is a giant boogeyman in the corner. The father looks and sees it, but he decides that he does not want to alarm his son. So he says that he cannot see it, that his son is imagining things. The boy repeats his claim, and the father says to the boy, "Well, if you pull the covers up over your head, the boogeyman will go away." The boy does that and looks again. And now, because the covers are blocking his view of the room, he can no longer see the boogeyman. So after a short time, he pulls the covers down to look in the corner again, and the boogeyman is still there. This conspiracy is like the boogeyman. It hides in the corner, and some people see it and are frightened. Some people see it and ignore it, and others do not want to see it at all. But ignoring the conspiracy does not make it go away. Pulling your head under the covers does not make the conspiracy go away. The conspiracy is real, and whether or not your father can see it, and whether or not you pull the covers up over your head, the conspiracy is still real. And the conspiracy does not want any of us to see it, and if we do, to pull the covers up over our head. But like the boogeyman, the conspiracy will not go away because we ignore it or cover it up. I intend on making this evidence that the conspiracy exists public so that the people of the world can prevent the future that the conspirators call the New World Order from coming into existence. I would like to explain now that when I was teaching in a community college years ago in Portland, Oregon, I had a discussion with a liberal student of mine. He told me, "You always find conspirators behind every bush." And I told him, "That's because liberals are always putting bushes in front of conspirators." So today I'm going to remove some bushes from in front of some conspirators. The material I will be presenting on this video today is an expansion of the video I made in 1990 entitled The New World Order. And what I will be presenting today will be startling. And as far as I can tell, I am the only one who is in opposition saying these things. But I believe strongly that I am correct about the future plan of this conspiracy. Now, I want to be honest with you and admit that this is a low-budget operation. I do not have a large budget to spend on production costs, so I'm making this video with very little money. I am sorry that the quality of the video might not be the very best, but I am hoping that you are watching it because you want to learn about the New World Order and that the quality of the video will not be the motive for your watching. Some of these slides are a little crooked, and I'm sorry for that, but that was the fault of the company that developed the slides. I want to also let you know that the research for this video has been done by me personally from materials that any of you can easily obtain. I have no foundation supporting me, no intelligence network feeding me information, and no team of highly trained experts doing my research. I am solely responsible for what you will be seeing today. I also want you to know that the books that I have taken slides of are from my personal library and are somewhat scratched or worn. I'm using my own materials, my own library copies, to let you know that I have read the book that I will be quoting from. Each slide that you will be seeing during this lecture was personally taken by me, and they might be a little dark, or the lines might not be straight, or they might not be exactly centered. But once again, I am doing the very best to present materials to you, the viewer, and have saved money by doing as much of this work myself. And my purpose is to make the cost of this video as economical as I can. So I will be presenting my 30 years of research that there is a conspiracy active in America, and that it has been involved in our affairs for centuries, and that their ultimate goal is what they have chosen to call the New World Order. Let me end this part of the lecture by discussing a simple truth. This nation was created by amateurs, and it will be saved by amateurs. When Paul Revere rode down the street shouting that the British were coming to start the American Revolution, our patriotic founding fathers responded by reaching for the old musket from off of the wall and going to the concrete bridge. Across the field came the English army, the best equipped, the best trained, the most prepared army in the world. The American patriot looked down the line at the others standing there, a bunch of farmers, shopkeepers, teachers, and others not prepared to defend freedom against the British. The patriot looked at his old musket, bent and rusting, and realized he couldn't stand against the British. The odds were just too great. But he and the other amateurs stood. And because they stood, we have freedom in America today. This nation was founded by amateurs, and it will be saved by amateurs. So I'm asking that you understand that I, too, am an amateur patriot, and that this lecture is the best I can make with the limited time and money. So with that understanding, I would like to now start the lecture. I want you to know that those of us who believe in the conspiratorial view of history just got a new ally, someone that all of us know just told the world that I was right. And that ally that confirmed 30 years of my research in just a few minutes last year was President of the United States, Bill Clinton. This man just told you that there was a conspiracy in the world and that he supported it. Time magazine named Bill Clinton Man of the Year in 1992. By the way, notice the unusual way that the cover artist placed Clinton's head so that it looked like he had two horns growing out of the top of his head. The letter M there in the back. I am sure that this was just a college prank that they were cleverly playing upon the President of the United States. But Time magazine was wrong. If they had wanted to name Clinton the Man of the Year, they should have named the two men who made Clinton the President of the United States. Time was wrong. Clinton was not Man of the Year. These two men were. Most people would recognize John Kennedy as being the man on the left, but few in America will recognize the man on the right. First of all, I want to apologize to Time magazine. I made that cover myself by taking a real cover, cutting out the main picture, and substituting the pictures of the two men shown in the cover. But I wanted to make a point. These are the two men that Bill Clinton acknowledged were responsible for his involvement in politics. As Bill Clinton ran for the presidency, his past was brought out so that all could examine it. It is known that he went to Boys Nation in Washington during the summer of 1963. That was between his junior and senior years of high school. It was during that summer that young Bill Clinton met the president. This is a picture of young Clinton on the left, shaking the hand of John Kennedy on the right. This picture had to be taken sometime before the summer of 1963 because President Kennedy was later assassinated in Dallas, Texas on November the 22nd, 1963. During the campaign, Mr. Clinton wrote a book with his vice presidential candidate, Al Gore. That book was called Putting People First. It contains the thoughts of the two candidates and was published in an attempt to get the reading public more familiar with their stands on the campaign issues. On page 217 of the book, Mr. Clinton has recorded a transcript of his acceptance speech that he gave on the night of July the 16th, 1992, to the American people from the podium of the Democratic Convention. This would be the largest audience Mr. Clinton would ever have at one time without a commercial break, and he told the American people more than they cared to know. The transcript of that speech continues on for several more pages, and on page 231 he is quoted as saying, "As a teenager, I heard John Kennedy's summons to citizenship." So what he was saying was that he attributes his interest in politics to John Kennedy. He states that Kennedy gave him a call into politics. But the next sentence was where he told the American people more than they cared to know. Clinton said, "And then as a student at Georgetown," here, by the way, he was acknowledging that he went to Georgetown University in 1964 after graduation from high school. Georgetown University is somewhere near Washington, D.C. Now going back to the quote, "I heard that call clarified by a professor I had named Carol Quigley." So here he was identifying a professor he had at Georgetown named Carol Quigley who really clarified or brought his desire to get into politics into focus. During the time that Clinton was at Georgetown University, Carol Quigley, his favorite professor, was writing a book entitled Tragedy and Hope. This book was published in 1966, sometime during Clinton's sophomore and junior year in college, because it is known that Clinton graduated in 1968. This is what the book says about Dr. Quigley's background. Carol Quigley, professor of history at the Foreign Service School at Georgetown University, formerly taught at Princeton and at Harvard. He has done research in the archives of France, Italy, and England, and is the author of the widely praised Evolution of Civilizations. He is a frequent lecturer and consultant for public and semi-public agencies. So the American citizen can now know what Quigley taught Bill Clinton and why our president acknowledged the debt to him as being the clarifier of his political views. On page 950, page 950 of Quigley's book, he wrote the following, and what I would like to do is read the quote in its entirety and then go back and review what he had just read. Carol Quigley said, There does exist and has existed for a generation an international Anglophile network. Anglophile means basically based in England, which operates to some extent in the way the radical right believes the Communists act. In fact, this network has no aversion to cooperating with the Communists or any group, and frequently does so. I know of the operations of this network because I have studied it for 20 years and was permitted for 2 years to examine its papers and secret records. I have no aversion to it or most of its aims, and have for much of my life been close to it or to many of its instruments. I have objected both in the past and recently to a few of its policies, but in general my chief difference of opinion is that it wishes to remain unknown, and I believe its role in history is significant enough to be known. Now let me analyze just what he said and how it impacted on the life of President Bill Clinton. Dr. Quigley wrote, "There does exist and has existed for a generation an international Anglophile network." Here Quigley was stating that there was an Anglophile network that had been around for some 40 or 50 years. As I said, the word Anglophile means that the network is primarily English, which operates in the way the radical right believes the Communists act. I guess that I'm a member of what Quigley refers to as the radical right. I believe in the conspiratorial view of history, and I believe that this conspiracy controls communism. Dr. Quigley is saying that this network operates as a communist network. And since I agree with him, he calls me a radical. Continuing with Quigley's quote, he said, "In fact, this network has no aversion to cooperating with the communists and frequently does so." Quigley went on page 954 of his book, to say this, "It was this group of people who provided much of the framework of influence with the communists, which the communist sympathizers and fellow travelers took over in the United States in the 1930s. It must be recognized that the power of these energetic left-wingers exercised was never their own power or communist power, but was ultimately the power of the international financial coterie." The word coterie means a group of people. So Quigley was saying that communism was controlled by a much bigger and much more powerful conspiracy made up of a group of capitalists. I made my discovery that communism was a part of something much bigger about the same time that Quigley wrote his book. I first started figuring this out in 1963, but didn't know that the communists were controlled by a capitalist conspiracy until maybe about 1968. I first read Cal Quigley's book probably in about 1970, so he confirmed what I already believe. I want to make the point very clear. Communism has been created by, controlled by, and sustained by what the world calls capitalism ever since 1848, when Karl Marx was hired by the very wealthy capitalists of his day to write the Communist Manifesto. So Quigley is telling the world what anyone can find out if they only do a little research. Quigley continued, "I know of the operations of this network because I have studied it for 20 years. Here Quigley is saying that he first became aware of this conspiracy around the end of World War II. Quigley continues, "and was permitted for 2 years in the early 1960s to examine its papers and secret records." Quigley is telling his readers that this network wanted him to make their existence public and invited him into their papers and secret records so that he could document its existence from their own materials. It is important at this point to point out that this network was admitting that they were a conspiracy because the word conspiracy is defined as two or more people meeting in secret for an evil or illegal purpose. So Quigley was helping to expose a conspiracy at their own request. Quigley continues, "I have no aversion to it or most of its aims, and have for much of my life been close to it or to many of its instruments." Here Quigley is taking a rare and extremely unusual step. He is admitting that he has no problems with what this conspiracy is or has been doing. Dr. Quigley tells us what the goal of this conspiracy is on page 324 of his book. "The powers of financial capitalism," meaning these conspirators, "had another far-reaching aim, nothing less than to create a world system of financial control in private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole. He went on to explain how this system would work. This system was to be controlled in a feudalist fashion by the central banks of the world acting in concert. By secret agreements arrived at in frequent private meetings and conferences. Notice that the conspirators want the world to be operated in a feudalist fashion. Feudalism is defined as an economic, political, and social system in medieval Europe in which land worked by serfs who were bound to it was held by vassals in exchange for military and other services given to overlords. A serf is defined as a person in feudal servitude bound to his master's land and transferred with it to a new owner. So a serf owns no property. A vassal is a person who held land in a feudalist system, doing homage and pledging fealty to an overlord, and performing military or other duties in return for his protection. Fealty is defined as the duty and loyalty owed by a vassal or a tenant to his feudal lord. So there were three classes of people in a feudalist system. Serfs, who owned no property, vassals who thought they owned property, and overlords who owned property, and serfs and vassals. So there is no private property in the system desired by the network that Quigley and Clinton are supporting unless you are an overlord. And guess who is volunteering to be the overlords? Notice that the overlords own the land and we work on it for them. And we fight the wars that they designed for us. And this is precisely the system that Dr. Quigley tells us that this conspiracy has been striving for as they cause major wars, revolutions, and depressions all over the world. And remember this, Bill Clinton supports the goals of this conspiracy. I have studied this conspiracy for some 30 years and must admit that Quigley's admission that he supports an evil conspiracy is the only one that I have ever found in such detail from someone inside the conspiracy. There are many historians who have discovered the existence of this conspiracy, but all that I know have been in opposition to it. Finding an historian who will admit to supporting this evil conspiracy is rare indeed. Dr. Quigley continues, I have objected both in the past and recently to a few of its policies. But in general, my chief difference is that it wishes to remain unknown, and I believe its role in history is significant enough to be known. So this is why Quigley entitled his book, Tragedy and Hope. Apparently he felt that it was a tragedy that they wished to remain unknown, but that they were the hope of the world. So Professor Quigley knows there is a conspiracy, and Quigley taught Clinton. And this conspiracy made Clinton president of the United States. And if you want to know how it is possible to know that Bill Clinton bought into the conspiracy and that we can know that he too has no aversion to it, you need to read my booklet entitled The Clinton Conspiracy. All of what I've just covered about Clinton's speech and his connection to Carol Quigley is available in this little booklet. If I could get the American people to read this booklet, it would be enough to save this nation from this conspiracy. But it is not likely that more than a handful will read the truth so that they can understand just who Bill Clinton is and where he came from. It might be helpful to show you an example of how this capitalist conspiracy uses the communist conspiracy. This is Diego Rivera, an internationally known painter and muralist who was born in 1886 and died in 1934. In 1933, Mr. Rivera was hired by a well-known American capitalist to paint a large mural in one of the buildings in a newly constructed complex of skyscrapers in New York City. That capitalist was Nelson Rockefeller, the brother of David Rockefeller and the grandson of the man who made their fortune, John D. Rockefeller. And the complex he was to paint the mural in was the RCA building in the Rockefeller Center in New York City. Mr. Rivera nearly completed the mural, when there was a public outcry against it, and Nelson Rockefeller made the decision to destroy it. This is a rather poor quality newspaper photo of the nearly completed mural taken just before it was destroyed. And this is the reason that the mural had to be destroyed. This is an actual photograph of the portrait that Mr. Rivera painted in the mural of Nikolai Lenin, the murderer of some 40 million Russians in the Communist Revolution in Russia. Mr. Rivera had painted his portrait in his mural in the Rockefeller Center, owned by the wealthiest capitalist of the day. Right after the scandal created by the destruction of the mural, Mr. Rivera painted a similar mural in Mexico City, Mexico, at the Palace of Fine Arts. This is a photograph of the completed mural. All of these photographs and the story concerning all of Mr. Rivera's work are contained in this book entitled Diego Rivera's Murals at the Rockefeller Center. Now, this is the portrait of Lenin in this second mural. Don't forget that Lenin was a brutal communist dictator, but Mr. Rivera felt that he was a man of unequaled quality. And in this section of the mural, he included the portraits of Karl Marx on the right, Friedrich Engels to his right, and Leon Trotsky on the left with the glasses. Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels were the so-called fathers of communism, and Leon Trotsky was a fellow murderer with Nikolai Lenin, because the two of them created the bloody Communist Revolution of 1917 in Russia. And Diego Rivera painted their portraits in his mural in Mexico City. But is it possible for the skeptic to say that Nelson Rockefeller did not know that Mr. Rivera was a communist sympathizer, and that he did not know that he would paint the portrait of Nikolai Lenin in his mural at the Rockefeller Center? But that just is not true because of two reasons. Rivera had submitted a sketch of the mural to Nelson prior to his being commissioned to paint the mural, and that sketch contained the portrait of Nikolai Lenin. That means that Nelson knew that the mural would have a picture of Lenin in it before it was painted. But more importantly, Diego Rivera joined the Mexican Communist Party in 1922, 11 years before he was commissioned to do the mural. In fact, Mr. Rivera became a staff member of El Machete, the newspaper of the Communist Party of Mexico. Irene Herner de Loria, the author of the book on Diego Rivera that I showed you a slide of, said this about Mr. Rivera. He saw his life as part of a group with the mission of implanting the socialist dream of Marx and Lenin in Mexico and all of America, and thus making it a reality. Mr. Rivera was asked to remove the portrait of Lenin after it was completed, but he refused, and the decision was made to destroy the entire mural. So here we see the connection between the communists and the capitalists. Dr. Quigley was right. Communism has been controlled by the capitalists for nearly 150 years. Now, I want to warn you that what I've discovered about the New World Order is not very pleasant. So I must warn you, you will not like what I'll be discussing during this lecture. I am sorry for that, but I feel that I have to bring you this information, whether it is pleasant or not. I'll be identifying the motive of Clinton's conspiracy in this lecture today, and I must tell you that this information will offend some of you. I'm also sorry for that, but I must tell the truth as it is and hope that those offended by it will want to take some corrective action. I want you to know that if I don't offend you, I want you to take offense that I didn't offend you, because I want to offend all of you equally. I want some of you to complain after watching this video that you were offended that I did not offend you with some of my comments. As I said, I want to offend all of you equally. Next, I would like to each of you to know that I would like to impanel each of you viewing this video as a member of a jury. And as jury members, you'll be asked to disregard all of the previous ideas you might hold about the conspiratorial view of history. I will ask that each of you honestly listen to all the evidence that I will be presenting. After you have heard the material in this lecture, then you will be free to reach your verdict as to whether or not you have believed my presentation. Therefore, I'm asking that each of you open up, allow me to present the evidence that the conspiratorial view of history is indeed the correct one, And the only way that I think we can prevent what this conspiracy has in mind for us is to educate others. So to educate as many as I can reach, I'm giving any one of you watching this video permission to make copies of it for any purpose whatsoever. I want as many people as is possible to see this material, and I'm hoping that each of you will arrange to make copies of this video lecture so that you can give them to others. And please help me in getting this material into the hands of the American people. I am going to expose a gigantic conspiracy that has been involved with more bloodshed than the mortal mind can comprehend. The goal of this conspiracy is simply to create a new world order. And that future is so horrible that anyone who knew what they had in store for them before it was set into place would do all within their power to prevent it. And the only way that I think we can prevent what this conspiracy has in mind for us is to educate others. Now, with this basic understanding about conspiracies, it is time to start our study of the New World Order. The first place to start is by talking about what this conspiracy calls the Old World Order, and I'd like to discuss the way we currently live our life. I'd like to talk about my life here in Tucson, my hometown, as being somewhat typical of life in America. As I start my day each morning, I get up in my own home. I own my own house and all the furniture in it. I have a TV set, a VCR, and a refrigerator. And by the way, that's about all. my carport has a private passenger automobile in it that I own outright. I live here in Tucson near where my mother lives, and she also owns her home, and it has a pool in the backyard. I was raised by my mother after my father died when I was a young boy of about five. But after my mother remarried, I was part of a traditional family with a father, a mother, and a brother. When I need gasoline for my automobile, I go to a privately owned gas station where I can purchase as much as I want. When I have need for medical care, I visit my personal physician, and if I need to go to a hospital, I go to one that is privately owned. I am single now, but I was once married, and my wife and I bought this home, and we lived together as a family. When a thief comes to take my private property from me, or when a murderer comes to harm me, I call the police because they exist to protect me, my family, and my property. I am free to travel wherever I want to go as long as I buy the gasoline if I choose to drive, or if I purchase an airline ticket from a privately owned airline company if I choose to fly. If I had had any children during my marriage, they would have been raised by my wife and myself as their parents and put into a private school because I was responsible for their care and education. And I worship the God that I believe in. I am free to exercise my religious views as long as they do not infringe on the rights of others. Notice that all I have described so far is based upon my right to my own life, my right to private property, and my right to marry. It's also based on my right to live with my wife or my parents if I choose to do so, and my right to practice my religion. And this is only a partial list of the rights that I believe I possess. But I am listing these few because I want to keep my illustration simple. Now, why do I choose to live this way? I was given free choice by the God that I worship. He gave me the ability to think, and because many people worship the same God, many people decided that we should live in a family, we should have the right to private property, we should have the right to practice our religion, and we should have the right to defend our right to life. In other words, each of us has been given the God-given right to life, liberty, and property. And since each of us has the right to defend ourselves against the murderer and the thief, we can give that right to government. However, we can only give to government the rights that we have ourselves. We can give to government no more power than we have ourselves, either individually or collectively. We cannot give to government any right that we do not have ourselves. Since I do not have the right to take your private property from you, I cannot give that right to government. And since I do not have the right, we do not have that right. And since we do not have the right to give government that power, then government does not have that right. But government is taking the property from one and giving it to another, and one can only wonder where they got that power if we didn't give it to them. And I'll discuss the reasons why the government does this in a few moments. And the reason we believe this way is this concept, in this concept of human rights, is because we believe in a creator God who taught us, thou shalt not murder and thou shalt not steal. And because we believe that, we punish others who steal or murder. And we learn about how he wants us to live our life through religion, the teachings of God. But since we are free to choose, we do not have to choose to live this way. We do not have to live with families. We do not have to have the right to private property. And we do not have to believe in a God. And when we choose not to live according to God's teachings, we can choose to live another way. And that other way is called the New World Order. The New World Order holds that man should organize his civilization so that there will be no family, no right to private property, and no right to worship. So quite simply, the New World Order is the exact opposite of the Old World Order. Said another way, if you have the right now, you won't have the right in the New World Order. So the New World Order is the exact opposite of everything we are doing now in our current civilization called the Old World Order. The New World Order will have no families, the New World Order will have no right to private property, and the New World Order will not tolerate the worship of God. Now, with this basic understanding of both the conspiracy and a little about why we live in families, go to churches or synagogues, have the right to life, and have the right to private property, we can now start our study of the New World Order. This is what we're going to see, to examine. What is this thing called the New World Order? This is a picture of George Bush, our past president. Mr. Bush was, at the time, the leader of the capitalist world. On August the 30th, 1990, the 31st of August, 1990, President Bush held a press conference. The newspaper says, quote, President George Bush declared that a new world order could emerge from the Middle East crisis. The Middle East crisis he was talking about was the war in Kuwait that American forces were fighting at the time. He described this new world as being, quote, a world quite different from the one we've known, unquote. Actually, that was not the first time that George Bush talked about a new world order. On October the 12th, 1979, Mr. Bush told the United Nations, we must establish a new world order based on justice, on equity, and on peace. And here's a picture of Mr. Bush delivering that speech. Now that obviously is not a picture of George Bush, but this is a picture of Fidel Castro, the dictator, in fact the communist dictator of Cuba. It was not George Bush that delivered that speech to the United Nations, it was Fidel Castro. But as I said, Fidel Castro is a communist, and he wants the same thing that George Bush, the capitalist, wants. This is the article in which Fidel Castro demanded a new world order. The article said that Castro demanded the establishment of a new world order to replace the, quote, unjust world system that exists today, unquote. Castro does not like the current world system that encourages the family, the right to private property, and a concept of national borders called nationalism, so he wants to replace these things with the new world order. Castro is saying that the communists can coexist with the capitalists in the new world order. But if the capitalist wants his society to support the family, the right to private property, and national borders, and Castro considers them to be unjust, how can both conditions coexist? Castro is saying that the lion and the lamb can lie down together in this new world order. But if Castro thinks these things are unjust, they cannot coexist. The new world order must either tolerate families, private property, and nationalism, or they will not be allowed to exist. It is impossible for the lion and the lamb to lie down together. You cannot have a world society where the communist wants to abolish the right to private property and where a capitalist wants to preserve it. Because what is justice to one is injustice to the other. In fact, this article confirms what I just said. On October the 15th, 1991, Fidel Castro pledged his support for a socialist system. Yet he and Bush both want a new world order, one a socialist and the other a capitalist. For those who think that since George Bush is no longer in office, the new world order is going away, let me show you this article in the July the 26th, 1993 Newsweek magazine. As you can see, the headline reads, "A Despot's Survival Guide, Dictators Mocking the New World Order." The New World Order did not die when George Bush left the presidency in 1993. This is Mikhail Gorbachev, the former head of the Russian government. The Milwaukee Sentinel of June the 5th, 1990 reported that, quote, "Gorbachev urges New World Order." The article said that Premier Gorbachev, quote, "called for the United States and the Soviet Union to be partners in building a new world order," unquote. But to show you that he was not embracing a capitalist new world order, Gorbachev told the world on November the 2nd, 1987, about 3 years before he supported the new world order, quote, "We are moving towards a new world, the world of communism. We," meaning the communists, "shall never turn off that road." He said that they would never, and I repeat, never turn off the road of communism. That means that he envisions the New World Order as being a world of communism. Now, this might very well be the flag of the New World Order. It was being put up during a Ronald Reagan summit meeting with the head of the Soviet Union in December of 1987. It shows the national emblems side by side. So the world has to answer the question, how can a communist coexist side by side with a capitalist? How can a communist want the same thing that a capitalist wants? We have been told that these two are enemies, but here we see that they both want the same thing. How can that be? I want you to know there is an answer, but it is not the answer that the world wants to hear, because communism and capitalism are not enemies, they are allies. They both want the same future. This is the first clue that something is wrong with the New World Order. Now, do not ask how this can be, because if you do, you will not like the answer you will be given. A Soviet communist stated it quite clearly. He said, quote, "Let us drive out the capitalists from earth and God from heaven," unquote. What George Bush wants is for his new world order to allow capitalists to operate and for religion to preach the existence of God. But the communist wants is what the communist wants is for his new world order to allow the communists to operate and for religion to be destroyed. Communism exists to destroy these things from out of the memory of man. Yet the new world order can only allow the principles of one or the other to exist, because communism said it must drive out the capitalists. So the new world order must be something that will make both the communists and the capitalists happy. And I want you to know that the new world order will make both the communists and the capitalists happy, simply because the new world order is pure communism. It will take me the next 4 hours or so of your time to prove that that statement is true. Because the New World Order of George Bush is the same New World Order of Mikhail Gorbachev. And it is because the New World Order is pure communism. Time magazine on December the 11th, 1989 had its cover show George Bush and Mikhail Gorbachev, quote, "building a new world," unquote. Apparently it has already started. The headline of the Vicksburg, Tennessee Evening Post of November 19, 1990 read as follows, quote, "Bush Gorbachev signed treaty create new world order," unquote. So apparently it has already started. Even the nation known as Iraq wants to be part of the new world order. This is Iraqi Foreign Minister Tariq Aziz. On January the 10th, 1991, he talked about the meeting he had at that time with American Secretary of State James Baker. He said this, concerning the New World Order, I said I have no problem with that order, and we would love to be partners in that order. During the war in Kuwait, this man's government was killing innocent people and destroying private property. Yet here he wants his government to be part of the New World Order. One can only wonder why it is that communists, tyrants, and capitalists all want the same thing. Comedian Groucho Marx was once asked why he was not a member of a particular country club. And Groucho Marx answered by saying that any country club that wanted him as a member wouldn't be worth joining. George Bush wants America to join a country club called the New World Order. But the nation of Iraq wants to be a member of the country club, and they believe in violence as a way of solving disputes. So we must all agree with Groucho Marx. Any country club that Iraq wants to join wouldn't be worth joining. But the New World Order is not something that is new. I'd like to give you some examples of others who have been talking about this New World Order. They've been talking about it, but we just haven't been listening. On January the 30th, 1976, a new document called the Declaration of Interdependence was introduced to the American people. It was signed by 32 senators and 92 representatives in Washington, D.C., and read in part, two centuries ago, our forefathers brought forth a new nation. Now we must join with others to bring forth a new world order. Historian Walter Mills maintained that prior to World War I, Colonel Edward Mandel House, the major advisor to President Woodrow Wilson, had a hidden motive for involving America in the war. This is a picture of the colonel on the left, and that is President Woodrow Wilson, shown on the right, the president at the time. The historian wrote this about Colonel House. The colonel's sole justification for preparing such a batch of blood was his hope of establishing a new world order of peace and security. The Associated Press reported on July the 26th, 1968, that New York Governor Nelson A. Rockefeller says, as president, he was running for the presidency at the time, as president, he would work towards international creation of a new world order in 1968. George Bush didn't talk about it until 1990, so this is not a new concept. It goes back until at least prior to Colonel Edward Mandel House. What is this country club that communists, tyrants, and wealthy capitalists want to join? Once again, what is the New World Order? Adolf Hitler, the socialist head of the German government during World War II, also spoke about a New World Order. He said, National Socialism will use its own revolution for the establishing of a New World Order. So now we have socialists also in favor of the New World Order, favored by communists, tyrants, and capitalists. Adolf Hitler killed 50 million people in World War II. He called his New World Order a thousand-year Reich. His New World Order was going to last for 1,000 years. Later on, we will see that George Bush's New World Order will also last for 1,000 years. And the reason for that is that both men wanted the same thing. On October the 27th, 1941, just before World War II started, President Franklin Roosevelt went on national radio and said, Hitler has often protested that his plans for conquest do not extend across the Atlantic Ocean. This is his entire design of his New World Order. Roosevelt went on to say, it is a plan to abolish all existing religions. Hitler wanted his New World Order to abolish religion. George Bush wants his New World Order to abolish religion. Hitler wanted his New World Order to last 1,000 years. George Bush wants his New World Order to last 1,000 years. And certain people are volunteering the United States as the nation which is going to put the New World Order into place. Former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger said this on April the 18th, 1975. Our nation is uniquely endowed to play a creative and decisive role in the new order which is taking form around us. The United States is going to give the world a, quote, new order, unquote. The New World Order was already taking shape in 1975, 18 years ago. And we even have a master strategy to get the world to accept the New World Order. The April 1974 issue of Foreign Affairs, the quarterly periodical issued by the Council on Foreign Relations, perhaps this nation's most powerful organization, had an article in it by Richard N. Gardner, the former Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for International Affairs, International Organizations in the John Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson administrations. In that article, Mr. Gardner said, "We are likely to do better by building our house of world order from the bottom up rather than from the top down. An end run around national sovereignty, eroding it piece by piece, is likely to get us to world order faster than the old-fashioned frontal assault. But the basic reason that these planners feel we need a new world order, a new way of doing things, was expressed by Manly P. Hall, perhaps the world's leading authority on the occult world of secret societies, who wrote this in his book entitled Lectures on Ancient Philosophy. He told us why we need to change the way of doing things. The time has not yet arrived when the average man is strong enough or wise enough to rule himself. And he explained who he considered worthy enough to rule those of the world considered by the experts to be incapable of governing themselves. He wrote, "Never will peace reign upon the earth until we are ruled by the fit." And another told us a little about just what this new way of doing things was going to be like. Aldous Huxley wrote a book entitled Brave New World Revisited, and he wrote this as follows. The older dictators fell because they could never supply their subjects with enough bread, enough circuses, enough miracles and mysteries. Under a scientific dictatorship, education will really work, with the result that most men and women will grow up to love their servitude. Of course, servitude is another word for slavery, and will never dream of revolution. There seems to be no good reason why a thoroughly scientific dictatorship should ever be overthrown. Now, why would anyone want to destroy religion? Alice Bailey answered that question on page 201 of her book. The emergence of a world religion is necessarily a profound difficulty. The new world religion is nearer than many think. The reason these people want to destroy religion is because they want to replace all religions with their new one. Alice Bailey is right. The new world religion is nearer than many think. Now, there are many who want to abolish religion. There is a new religion spreading around the world called the New Age religion. I briefly mentioned it before, but it is time to take a longer look at it. One of the more articulate of their writers is Terry Cole Whitaker, a former Christian evangelist. She apparently felt that Christianity did not meet her needs, so she renounced her ministry and started teaching the New Age religion. And she has written this book entitled The Inner Path. In this book, she wrote, "There will be no more God of vengeance for us to fear, and therefore no more God-fearing people. The New Age will mean the end of religion." She wrote that it will also mean the end of government. Everyone will govern themselves. There will be no more tyrants. I'm sorry, I've got to get the next slide here. There will be no more tyrants and no more organizations to tell us what is good for us and what is bad. Notice that she called religion tyranny. This is a very common position for those New Agers and others to take, as we shall continue to see. And Terry Cole Whitaker tells us that this will be the future of the New World Order. The New World will be a world in which there will be none of the things that make up the misery of the world today. The things that make up the misery of the world today are the things that guide our present civilization, meaning the old world order. Now back to Terry Cole Whitaker. We have an opportunity to create a new reality and to put an end to the old. If each man and woman is to decide for themselves what is right and wrong, there is no such thing as sin. Cherry Cole Whitaker believes this as well. She wrote, "You are guiltless. None of what you have done is wrong in the highest sense. There is no such thing as wrong in God's world." And then she went on to say, "The good news is that sin is nonsense." What she is saying is that God messed up the universe, and Lucifer and man's mind, his reason, will straighten it all out. That's what the New Agers believe. Then she continued, "There is no one single right way and no one single truth. Everybody's truth is right for them. It's all right to do whatever brings you happiness. Worship yourself. You are the light." This is the teaching of the public schools today in America in the field of sex education. It is being taught without any morality. There is no morality in the sex education teaching in our schools today. Each individual decides what is right and wrong for themselves. Parents, the rabbi, the priest, the minister cannot teach anyone what is right and wrong about sex today. Each individual is to decide for himself. A young man attends the sex education class in his public school. He is taught the mechanics of sex, but not what is right and wrong. He decides that a young lady in one of his classes is pretty. She is sexually arousing to the young man, so he takes her into the bushes. She cries rape because she did not consent to the act. The government comes to arrest the young man, and he asks the arresting officer why they are arresting him. He is told that rape is wrong because the young lady did not consent to the act. He replies that he was taught that there were no rights and wrongs in regard to sex, and he explains that what he did was not wrong because the school taught him that what he decides is right is right. So he decided it was right to take the young lady into the bushes. But the government says that what he did was not permissible because there are rights and wrongs in sex. Consider the quandary that this puts into the mind of the young man. On the one hand, he is taught that there is no morality in sex. He can decide for himself, and he decided that rape was acceptable. And on the other hand, he is told by the government that he cannot decide that there are no rights and wrongs in sex. The crime is called rape, and he is going to jail. This is called hypocrisy. One branch of government says that rape is acceptable, another says that it isn't. But this is the quandary the government wants our young people to be in. And it also illustrates just how foolish this philosophy is. It can only cause confusion amongst our young people, and it has. And that is why teenage rape is on a dramatic rise throughout the United States. We all see it, but no one tells us why it is occurring, and now we know. So new thoughts about how we should live our lives are surfacing. There are many who have been telling us about these changes. I'd like to return to the writing of Benjamin Krem, one of those recommending major changes in our civilization. Mr. Krem is a leader in the New Age religion, and he has been talking and writing about the changes coming in the future for several years. I'd like to quote once again from his book entitled Maitreya's Mission in 1986. I will explain who this individual named Maitreya is a little later, but at this point I wanted to read a quote from Mr. Krem's book from page 3. Here's what he wrote. "We are moving into a period of climax leading to events which will fundamentally alter life as we know it. Tremendous changes are taking place in all areas of life, preparatory to the establishment of entirely new modes of social living and relationship. We are standing at the beginning of a new era, a new cosmic cycle." So Mr. Krem is telling us that tremendous changes are coming. We are going to alter life as we know it. He went on to say, "We are about to witness profound changes in all our institutions and structures, political and economic, religious and social, scientific, educational, and cultural. Eventually, this will mean total change of all of our institutions. So people are talking about changing our civilization, the way that we live our lives. We will continue our study of this New World Order after this break. Someone else who has been writing about what the new changes are all about was Alvin Toffler in his 1980 book entitled The Third Wave. He wrote this: a new civilization is emerging in our lives. This new civilization brings with it new family styles, changed ways of working, loving, and living, and new political conflicts. Mr. Toffler in 1980 was talking about the changes we are seeing today. He was talking about how one-parent families would become far more common. Now, this is an article in the July 26, 1993 Newsweek magazine. It shows that more single women are choosing motherhood. That means that there are increasing numbers of one-parent families in the United States. Children are growing up without a father. The two-parent family is becoming a thing of the past. The wife in the two-parent family is increasingly out in the workplace instead of being at home raising the children where our traditional family has placed her. Television is making certain that we understand that single parenting is acceptable. This is Newsweek magazine, or is a Newsweek article in their August 30th, 1993 magazine. The title and subtitle read, Fractured Family Ties, Television Forget Kids Shows. The network's new theme is single parenting. The article pointed out that there are three messages from the coming 1993 television season. Parents rarely come in pairs. Nationwide, one in four families is headed by a single parent. But on the coming television programs, nearly two-thirds will be run by a single mom or dad. Number two, we're being taught by TV, father knows least. When its dad is on his own, expect major dysfunction. In other words, dads cannot run a family alone, but moms can. And the number three lesson is, parents are just overgrown kids. In other words, fathers running a one-parent family is not good. Moms running it is better, but not by much. And finally, parents are not capable of raising their children. And someone will be offering a better solution. The government will raise your children for you, and they will do it correctly. It is happening right now on our television sets, and America continues to watch their television and learn about the New World Order. Toffler was talking about other changes in the family as well. The Arizona Daily Star, our local newspaper here in Tucson, of October the 3rd, 1991, said that legalizing gay marriages would benefit everyone. The article failed to convince me that it would, so I am one member of this everyone who would not benefit by the legalization of gay marriages. The ultimate goal of all of these thoughts is the destruction of the one man, one woman marriage. Life magazine a few months ago had a series of articles that talked about the traditional family, meaning one man, one woman, and the children all living together. The article said, families have been through a bad time in recent years. It talked about how two gay men were striving to make their family work. We've never defined a family to mean two gay men before, but we are now. This is another article that says that a court had ruled that a gay couple was now included in the definition of a family. Our courts are now defining the word family to include two gay men. I will predict that very shortly, homosexual and lesbian marriages will become legal. Mr. Toffler talked about changed ways of loving. Lesbianism and homosexuality are currently being taught in our public schools as alternative lifestyles. Now here we see that the Massachusetts Supreme Court recently approved the adoption of a five-year-old girl by a lesbian couple. Someday soon, even bestiality will be considered, quote, normal, unquote. Mr. Toffler also discussed new ways of living. The marriage commitment will be looked down upon as being archaic and old-fashioned. So the new practice will become living with your partner and don't marry your partner, him or her, because this will cause grief in your relationship. These are the changes we see happening daily in America. These are the changes that we see, but we do not understand that they are part of a major plan to destroy the family as a unit. In other words, in the New World Order, there will be no family unit. So we must be taught that it is obsolete, out of step, and worthy of being replaced. Don't forget, Mr. Toffler wrote this in 1980. He was indeed a true prophet, or was he told beforehand what was being planned? Now there is another major change taking place in America. America's tradition was for the woman upon marriage to take the name of her husband as her own, dropping her maiden name. Now she often takes her mother's maiden name or her former maiden name and hyphenates it, such as Margaret Joan Smith. This is a move from the traditional position where the woman took her husband's name. U.S. News and World Report reported in June of 1993 that a married couple combined their names to form a new name. Her last name was Flaherty, and his last name was Flaherty, and her last name was Silverman, so they combined their names so that both now became Flaherman. So I guess we will see more of that in our society. In the New World Order, meat eating will be replaced with vegetarianism, which will become mandatory. Benjamin Cram, a believer in all of these changes, wrote on page 193 of his book, "Out of this change will come a vegetarian diet for mankind. This will be the norm. In the new age, vegetarianism will become the norm. It does become necessary. So in the New World Order, there will be no meat eating. In fact, everything is going to change. Even the differences in the sexes will be eliminated, as much as can be achieved by the planners. This is already happening in our world. Take, for instance, the case of Michael Jackson, perhaps the world's biggest music star. Now, why is he such a major media personality? Why does the major media tell us about his every move? Why is it that he has had more plastic surgery than nearly anyone else? Because someone wanted him to look like a sexless young man. We are not able to tell if he is a male or a female. This is a picture of Michael Jackson with Brooke Shields, and it appears as if he is wearing a woman's makeup. He has had all of that surgery to make him look sexless. He is now wearing makeup to make him look sexless. And the question we are to ask ourselves when we see Michael Jackson, is he male or female? He looks like his sisters, but the world tells us he is a man. But the question is why he has allowed himself to be made to look like a sexless young boy girl. And it is because in the world order, in the new world order, distinctions between the two sexes will be worn down until someday we will all look like Michael Jackson. There will be no sexual differences in the new world order. And someone else is contributing to the destruction of the lines between male and female. This is Prince, the famous music star. According to this article, he just changed his name to a symbol, into a sign that combines the symbols for male and female. So Prince no longer even has a name. He will be referred to by a wordless symbol. And the thought that the future human would be sexless is not new. This is an article that appeared in the Arizona Daily Star on August the 21st, 1993. The headline reads, "Androgyny as Art." The word androgyny is defined as both male and female in one. So we have a new word to define, if you're not familiar with it, androgyny, both male and female. The article showed pictures of male and female actors and actresses who have performed as a sexless person as early as 1930. The first mention of a performer appearing to be both male and female is Rudolph Valentino, the silent screen leading man. The article said that he used eye makeup to appear androgynous. The article said that Marlene Dietrich also dressed up as a man in the movie entitled Morocco in 1930. So the movie industry started educating the American people that being both sexes was acceptable in at least 1930. Androgyny is not new. We just didn't understand that it was part of a greater picture. Because in the New World Order, there will be no sexual distinctions as far as is humanly possible. and to show you that this is now becoming more commonplace, this is an article that appeared in our local newspaper on January the 21st, 1994, announcing a new play that will mix dance, film, and music around the theme of androgyny. The choreographer of the play says that his play is about the freedom to choose from all of the elements of your personality. He said, "We are all male and female. We're all boys and girls. So it is becoming a thing to dance and sing about. The New World Order is getting closer." Now here's another example of how the world is changing right under our noses. Arizona House Bill number 2489 will make it a criminal offense to manifest evidence of prejudice based on race, color, religion, national origin, sexual orientation, gender, or disability. So the question can now be asked as to how it will be possible for a person to legally choose to marry a white Christian American non-handicapped female without breaking the law, if that is that person's choice. Because ultimately, it will be against the law to legally discriminate in the choosing of one's life partner. The goal is to simply destroy marriage by making it an illegal act of discrimination to choose your mate by yourself. The government will have to find a wife or husband for you so that you will not be guilty of all of this discrimination. And to show you that this is not a joke and that it is already happening, this is a picture of Reverend Moon of the Unification Church. Reverend Moon recently married 30,000 couples in a single ceremony. The men and women have not met their prospective husband or wife until a few moments before the wedding. So this is a picture of thousands of those marriages taking place all at once. Each one of those couples had not met their wife or husband until that morning. And one can ask why this was taking place, and the answer is obvious. Because each person could avoid all of that discrimination by having someone else choose their mate for them. No one would be guilty of an age group if someone else chose his wife for him. Each man would not be guilty of racial discrimination because he freely chose to marry a white woman or a black woman if someone chose his wife for him. Now here's a book that discusses this new way of loving. This book is entitled Unholy Matrimony. And the caption underneath the picture in the catalog says, quote, "Marriage has become an anachronism irrelevant to our society. Because marriage deprives women of their right to separate identity, to own property, to have a private income." The caption goes on to say, "This book challenges our assumptions of marriage and family, and to show you how the book publisher feels about the subject, this is a close-up of the book cover, and it appears as if that is a devil behind the little bride and groom on the top of the wedding cake." So the book cover appears to be saying that it is time for the devil to look at marriage and then abolish it as a social condition. It is becoming quite clear that the traditional family of one male husband, one female wife, and children will be destroyed right here, right now in America. The statement that America's survival depends upon the preservation of the family is true. And to show you that values are changing, this is the February 10, 1992 Newsweek article about then-candidate Bill Clinton's affair with Jennifer Flowers, the beautiful television personality, not his wife. The article reports that most men and women in America interviewed during their survey of people's attitudes said, quote, "We don't care if Clinton has been unfaithful," unquote. What they were saying was that we, the American people, don't care if Bill Clinton does not keep his vows to his wife to be faithful. And if he does not have to keep his vows to his wife, he does not have to keep his vows to the American people after we elect him president. In other words, we didn't care then, and we won't have to care now either. So you can expect Bill Clinton to lie and change his promises, and the American people won't care. And that is exactly what Bill Clinton is doing, and that is exactly how the American people are reacting. So I started saying this before he was even inaugurated. But an article that his wife Hillary wrote might be the reason that Bill Clinton went looking for another woman during his affair with Jennifer Flowers. Hillary Clinton wrote an article for the Harvard Educational Review back in 1974. She claimed that marriage was similar to slavery. Here's what she wrote, quote, "The basic rationale for depriving people of rights in a dependency relationship is that certain individuals are incapable of or undeserving of the right to take care of themselves, and consequently need social institutions specifically designed to safeguard their position. Along with the family, past and present examples of such arrangements include marriage, slavery, and the Indian reservation system." So Hillary Clinton, the wife of our president, believes that marriage is a form of slavery because men and women cannot take care of themselves. Notice that I did not say these things. The wife of our current president did. All of this is happening because the traditional view of one man marrying one woman for life and being faithful to that one wife is not true anymore. Our society is now accepting unfaithfulness where this would have been never been with the word. Forgive me, let's start over again. Our society is now accepting unfaithfulness where this would have never been tolerated just a few years ago. And I want you to know that in the new world order, there will be no more traditional families. And it is a reasonable question to ask, why is it that anyone would want to destroy the family as the basic building block of traditional civilization? One man, Benjamin Krim, answered that question on pages 184 and 185 of his book. This is what he said. All the old institutions, and the family is also one of the institutions, are breaking down. The new time is to do with the restructuring of our relationships, the extending of our allegiance and our identification from the family to a larger group, from the larger group to the community, from the community to the community of nations. Our allegiances are being transferred by those in favor of the New World Order. We are no longer to think of ourselves as individuals, but as part of a group. He continues this thought on page 241. The ideal of this New World Order is divorced from all nationalistic concepts and aspirations. The whole world knows that the Iron Curtain between so-called communism and so-called capitalism has come down, but many in the world do not understand why it was, that suddenly the communists were admitting that their system was a failure and that they had imprisoned their citizens behind an Iron Curtain. And there are people who know the answer to that question. One is Alice Bailey, and she tells us why that is so on page 130 of her book entitled The Externalization of the Hierarchy. She wrote, Great Britain, the United States of America, and the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, meaning the USSR, are working out the principles of federation, of relation, and of diffusion of bodies into concentrated wholes. So the fall of the Iron Curtain was intended to signal the beginning of the federation of the Great Britain, the USSR, and America into some sort of regional government. And to start this process, the Iron Curtain separating the free world from the communist world had to fall. And it has been reported that the New World Order started falling with the fall of the Berlin Wall. And here's one indication that that statement is true. This article in Time magazine stated that the old world order fell when the Berlin Wall fell. So we now have a starting date for the beginning of the new world order. It began when the Berlin Wall fell. One of the other cornerstones of a private society or a free society is the right to private property. We are not free unless we get to keep that which we produce. We are not free unless we can strive to produce enough goods to enable us to enjoy a better life. And even this most basic human right to civilization is under attack. We will become slaves to those who have the power to decide how much we can produce and what we can do with it. This is Maurice Strong, the Secretary General of the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development, and here's what he said. It is clear that current lifestyles of the affluent middle class involving the ownership of motor vehicles, household appliances, air conditioning, suburban housing are not sustainable. So the affluent middle class are living too well. We will not be allowed to sustain that standard of living. It will have to be reduced. Notice that Mr. Strong was not talking about the rich with their affluent lifestyle. He was talking about the middle class. They are living too well. Government will have to equalize the income of the citizens of the world. That thought that the middle class was living too well was echoed by Benjamin Krim, the author we have quoted before. He wrote, "For the advanced developed nations of the West, that third of the world which today grabs, exploits, and wastes most of the food, raw materials, and the energy of the world, a new experience, the wilderness experience, will become necessary. We will have to live more simply." The wilderness experience he is talking about is the lifestyle of our great grandparents who lived basically off of the land in a very simple lifestyle. These people had no automobiles, VCRs, TVs, summer cabins, pleasure boats, etc. So to get us into the wilderness experience, there will have to be a war on property rights, meaning the right to keep that which we produce. The Detroit News and Free Press wrote this on September the 15th, 1991. It talked about what William Riley, the administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency administration, said, and this is what he said in 1991. Property rights are a quaint anachronism. Property rights, like the one man, one wife marriage, are a quaint anachronism. The right to private property, along with the one man, one wife marriage, will have to be replaced because they have been termed obsolete for the New World Order. It is happening right now beneath our noses. And the reason we are not objecting to this is because we simply do not understand that the destruction of the staples of our civilization is part of a plan, because there will be no family nor private property rights in the New World Order.